Good morning and welcome to Monkton and Prestwick North Parish Church. For those of you that don't know, my name is Elaine Wardrop and I'm an elder here, and I'm going to be leading worship this morning with the help of many, many others, and I'm very thankful for that. Before we come to worship, Sandy's just got a few things to come and share with us.
Morning. So there's a Presbytery of Ayr meeting on the 23rd of August, and we've got a citation to the congregation to read for 2 weeks. So this is the second reading of it. Citation to appear at Presbytery. Notice is hereby given that in connection with the final version of the Presbytery Mission Plan for the Presbytery of Ayr, the Presbytery will meet to approve a final version of the Mission Plan at True Knowe Parish Church on the 23rd day of August at 7 o'clock. The congregation is cited to attend in their own interest. In accordance with church law, all congregations require to be cited to appear in the Presbytery meet to approve a final version of the Mission Plan on the 23rd of August. It's not mandatory for congregations to speak, however, if the opportunity will be provided for one person to speak, if required. And we've got a draft version of the building audit. So Monkton and Prestwick South, Monkton and Prestwick North and Prestwick South are uniting. Retention of all Monkton and Prestwick North buildings due to locations better servicing the parish. Disposal of Prestwick South Church, but retention of the South Church Hall to meet known needs within the community and fulfil mission outreach. And just a quick notice that Robert asked me to bring to your attention, Colin Cranson of Allenfield Road has passed away. There's no funeral details at the moment, but I'll make them available when they are. Thank you.
Thanks, Sandy. Let's be still and lay aside all that distracts us. Let's be still and leave the distractions of the past week behind. Let's be still and lay aside the things we face in the week ahead. Let's come as we are to be in the presence of our faithful God. And we'll begin our worship singing together from Mission Praise 1003, My Jesus, My Saviour.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy One, Life Giver, Shepherd and Guide, we come before you in humble adoration. We are delighted to offer this time of worship. We come to sing of your amazing love for us, revealed in Jesus. We come to hear your word anew and to learn more of you. We come to offer our prayers and our gifts. We come aware of our faults and failings. We come glad that when we choose to lose our way and walk away from you, you are patient and wait for us to return. We acknowledge that we have failed you on many occasions and are glad to know that each time when we return to the fold, you forgive us. We are encouraged to know that when we are lost, you are always looking for ways to help us return to the fold, and you never give up on us. We are humbled by your unconditional love and desire to be in a full relationship with us. You are always willing to forgive and ready to restore us into a right relationship with you. Thank you. May we learn to love as you do and create relationships with others as you do with us. So be it. Amen.
Thank you, Sandy. So I'm just going to give Sandy a wee minute to get back up, because I need her. I have a slide, and there are some things that are going to come onto that slide. Shut your eyes, you're not supposed to see that. Shut your eyes. Just block that out, okay? That's okay. So you're going to block out what you just saw. You didn't see that. And some things are going to come onto the screen, and I want you to have a wee think and see if you know what the connection's going to be. Okay? So here's the first one. It's a number. Any idea what that number might be about? 254. No? Here's the next one. It's a number. And it's 129. So how could that be connected to that other number? Any ideas? No? No, not quite. Right, here's another one. Oh, it's another number. Okay, so that number's connected to those other two numbers. Any ideas? Sorry? Oh, that's you've just uncovered an extra clue. That's an extra clue. Yep. So yes, that's part of the answer. Okay, here's another number. How could that be connected to those other two numbers that, as Stuart says, added together and make that top number? It could be. Yep, you could be here for a while. Right, here's the last number. Okay? So they're all connected. No? Okay, this is a better clue. Have a look at this. This is a picture. Do you know where that picture is? That's a clue. No? Okay, here's another picture. Surely now. It's a stadium. Do you know where it is? Where? No. You'll definitely get it this time. Birmingham, it's the Commonwealth Games. So, those numbers are linked because 254 is the number of Scottish team members. So Stuart was right, because 129 are female competitors, and 125 are male. I would have thought that was the other way around, but it's not. So can you guess what the 51 is? Number of medals. So what about the 13? Is the number of gold medals. That's right. It's a wonderful achievement, isn't it, for such a small country as ours, and it makes you very proud to be Scottish. I don't know about you, but when I saw Eilish McColgan getting her medal, I found that really emotional. It's really something to be proud of. It's not just a wonderful achievement for Scotland, but also for each individual athlete. Do you think one day, a couple of months ago, they just decided that they'd enter the Commonwealth Games and have a bash at winning some medals? No, of course they didn't. They have to train really hard in a way that we can never imagine. They probably have to compete in many, many competitions and get beaten before they ever get to represent their country, competing in the Commonwealth Games, never mind to win medals. They really have to persevere to get at this level, at being the very best they can be in their sport. It's a real endurance test, and they really need to have faith in their ability to achieve this standard. They can't see their medal when they're striving for it, but they have to trust that all their hard work will one day pay off, and have the faith that one day they will achieve their goal. For some of the athletes, they may not achieve a medal, but that doesn't mean they're going to stop trying. They will keep persevering and try harder, pressing on towards achieving that goal. That's a wee bit like us. We have faith in our faithful God. We trust in him even though we can't yet see him. So how can we have faith in a God that we can't see? Well, we work hard to learn more. We strive to work hard helping others and loving others the way Jesus would. We try every day to have a better, closer relationship with him and to get better and better at living out our faith so that we can be the very best we can be. And sometimes when things are a bit tough, we don't stop trying either. We fix our eyes on our Jesus and persevere, running the race just like the athletes do, so that we too can be the very best we can be, always trusting in our ever faithful God. And now we're going to continue our worship singing together from Mission Praise 809, Blessed Be the Name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, they are saved. Glory to the name of the Lord. Glory to the name of the Lord. Glory to the name of the Lord. Just run into it, they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, they are saved. Holy is the name of the Lord. Holy. The name of the Lord. strong tower. The righteous run into it, they are saved. The right of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, they are saved.
Today's first reading is from Psalm 91. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you, no disaster will come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread upon the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Second reading is from Hebrews 11. Verse 29. By faith the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land, but when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. By faith the walls of Jericho fell after the people had marched around them for 7 days. By faith the prostitute Rahab, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. Others were tortured and refused to be released so that they might gain a better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging, while still others were chained and put in prison. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, they were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and ill-treated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, and in caves and holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with the perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Amen. Thanks be to God for this reading from his word.
Thank you. And now we're going to continue our worship singing together, There Is a Higher Throne.
Before before the sun we stand, made faultless through the Lamb, believing hearts find promised grace. Salvation come. Hear heaven's voices sing their thunderous anthem, rings through emerald courts and sapphire skies.
Song. So we're going to pray this morning to our ever-loving, ever-living, wonderful King. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give thanks for your gentle and enduring love, for sending us your Son Jesus to show us the way to live, our life itself, for our lives and for this world. Crack our hearts wide open to allow the Holy Spirit in to feel warmth, joy, and hope. Grant us the grace to respect this world so that we in faith may see it through your eyes, hear it through your ears, and touch it through your hands, and leave it as a place pleasing to you. Lord, teach us to pray with love and understanding, to try and enter into the real needs that are around us. And gracious Heavenly Father, we pray for those who feel they've no need for you, who have no patience, for those who agonize over the injustice. We pray for those who are wonderful and show mercy and compassion, for those who work for peace where no peace seems possible. Heavenly Father, we look around, we pray together for a world gone wrong, disturbed, unsettled, through famine, war, or death. And when plans go really wrong, as often they do, or when we try to step in and help at the wrong time, even with the best intentions, Sometimes we don't have the right gift, we don't have the right time. We can't see the big picture. May we remember to seek and listen for your wisdom, to get your will and direction for our lives, and truly believe that you will lead and protect us. We, your sons and daughters, pray for and leave before you this morning those who need your prayer. We give thanks and prayer at MPN for our minister Alistair and worship leaders who teach your words, for those who are office bearers, those who nourish and nurture our youth organisations, our community church food bank volunteers, our guild who carry out the plans from the Church of Scotland, and the many who willingly carry out tasks within your church, in your name, with no fuss, no requirement of thanks, as all is to glorify you, our Lord, and not ourselves. We pray at this time for our presbytery, our local ministers and churches who are coming to terms with the necessary change. We pray for healing today from depression, lifelong disease, those waiting for results, those who are waiting to start treatment. We pray for miraculous healing because we know you are as capable of fixing our physicalities as you are to holding the oceans in place as the earth spins round. Through your son's death on the cross, we have the opportunity to be healed spiritually. By believing in Jesus, we are connected straight to you in prayer and presence. Bless our hearts to believe in you. You beyond our heart's capacity. Strengthen our faith where it is weak, and strengthen our resolve to linger in your presence a little longer every day. Take away our pain according to your will in your time. We're not promised a painless life on earth, but you do want us to live a happy one. Send your spirit to help us see past our circumstances and onto your calling on our lives. Fill our hearts with hope as we wait on you to move in our lives. Lord Jesus Christ, as we share in fellowship and worship today, help us build into our lives the things we have heard about and considered today, that we will truly be a community of living faith which draws others to know you too. Amen.
Thank you, John. And now we're going to continue our worship singing together, Who Is There Like You?
Thank you.
looks to you, and you provide for all you have made. So I'm lifting up my hands, lifting up my voice, lifting up your name. In your grace I rest, for your love has come to me. My voice, lifting up your name, and in your grace I rest, for your love has come to me and set me free, and I'm trusting in your word, trusting in your cross, trusting in your blood. And all your faithfulness, for your power at work in me is changing me.
When I was preparing for this morning, I decided to look up the dictionary and see what the definition of faith is. And it says this: faith, complete confidence in someone or something. That seems an appropriate description, I thought. Everyone exercises faith that fits into that description every day, whether they are followers of Christ or not, by putting their faith in humans or worldly possessions. We get on a plane and we trust that the pilot is going to safely fly us to our destination. That's faith. We switch on our computer and we trust that the Wi-Fi, hopefully, will allow us to communicate anywhere in the world. That's faith. We flick a switch in our homes and trust that the power will turn on the electricity and the lights. That's faith. These are all examples of us having faith in a worldly sense. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't have that faith or confidence in someone or something in this modern world, but for our true description of faith and trust in our one true God, every believer needs to turn to the description of faith found in our true dictionary, the most precious book we can ever own, our manual for life, our Holy Bible. We read our proper definition of Christian faith in Hebrews. It says this: faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we cannot see. We have faith that God will do what he says he will do, and faith is being sure of that. Faith is being obedient because of that. We spoke earlier about our athletes. Do they get to their goal by being easily distracted? No, I don't think so. Is it an easy race to run? I wouldn't think so. Of course it's not, but it's possible, yes, because they keep their eyes fixed on the goal, their prize, and they run that race, however long it takes, with real endurance. Hebrews reminds us that we are linked through faith with well-known people of faith in the past, and we will be in the future with Jesus, our perfect example of faith, our pioneer. But this is about living through these in-between years now. We are part of the story. We are living in the story right here, right now. And these in-between years are not easy. Faithfulness can be costly when contemporary culture dismisses you as irrelevant or the butt of a joke. This unease is made harder when you, those you thought to be fellow travellers in the church refused to listen or consider to change. We can all easily become settled in our ways and resist the challenge of a faith that's intended to reshape the world in which we live. That just seems like such a huge order. How could we possibly be part of that? We're both disturbed and challenged to think through our relationship with God and what God might expect from us. I'm sure we can all name some of the cloud of witness in our own time. Not just the names known to all, but those personal to us. Those who were there when we needed them, teaching us the most incredible importance of faith through their teaching and their example. And we can, I'm sure, all name the cost of living in these in-between years. Those things, those difficulties, those trials that make it so challenging to run the race. And why it's so important to do so with endurance, perseverance, and unwavering faith in our faithful God. I think most of us would agree that the church in the West is at crisis point. The ways we have known and cherished no longer work in our society. Tinkering at our faith is not enough anymore. Radical change is required for individuals, congregations, and for the national church. We need to take our role seriously in the reshaping of our churches and our local communities, ensuring an inclusive, welcoming and non-judgmental environment. We need to concentrate on the building and developing of relationships of trust and of mutual respect. An important part of this is creating an environment that allows all to express their feelings honestly, whether they're feelings of anger, disappointment, fear, excitement, joy, or hope. It feels so much is happening to us in our churches across the land, rather than with us at times. We must not sit back with a what will be attitude. God doesn't call us to be faithful when all is rosy in the garden. He calls us to be faithful through the trials too. Living through a crisis isn't easy, whether it's personal or in the church, and the way forward isn't always obvious. We are to remain faithful in prayer and trust God in his plan, trusting that he is in control. We should be open, honest, and kind to ourselves and to each other. We have no option other than to face the storms, and there will be many. We need to hold the hand of a neighbour and look to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. In the difficult times of trial and trouble, we may feel that God has left us, but Psalm 91 that Pat read for us earlier is all about God's protection. It encourages us not to be afraid. It could be misunderstood as a recipe for a trouble-free life, but when we read on in the Psalm, it's clear that those who love the Lord will not avoid trouble. God doesn't promise a trouble-free life. Rather, he promises he will rescue and protect us and answer our prayers. But more than that, he promises, I will be with you in the trouble. This is what makes all the difference. Even in our darkest times, our faithful God is with us. We are never alone. We don't know the author of Hebrews. However, it is sometimes referred to as the fifth gospel. Our four gospels describe Christ's ministry on earth, whereas Hebrews describes his ministry in heaven at God's right hand. If you study the book of Hebrews, you'll notice that Jesus is prominent throughout all the pages. These Jewish Christians were probably undergoing fierce social and physical persecution for their faith from both the Romans and the Jews. Christ hadn't yet returned to establish his kingdom, and the people needed reassured that Christianity was true and that Jesus was indeed the Messiah. Judaism that they were devoted to was in no way second rate or easy. It expressed true worship and devotion to God. But although these Christians had been seeking the Messiah for centuries, this message was still difficult to accept. The old Judaism and the new Christianity are both religions revealed by God. Hebrews is written to Jews who are understandably evaluating Jesus or struggling with this new faith. The main message from Hebrews is that Christianity is superior. Christ is supreme and completely sufficient. Jesus is better. That explains why one of the key words in Hebrews is better. It occurs more than 10 times as the writer consistently emphasises that Jesus' way is always better. Hebrews also shows us the importance of the Old Testament with the New and the New Testament with the Old. You just simply can't have one without the other. Having established the superiority of Christianity earlier in Hebrews, the writer moves on to practical implications of following Christ. The readers are encouraged to hold on to their new faith, encourage one another, and look forward to Christ's return. The message is the same for us today. Whatever we are considering today as the focus of our life, Christ is always better. Jews who had become Christians were tempted to fall back into Judaism because of uncertainty. Today's believers are tempted to fall back into minimum requirement and giving too much to the busyness of life and other distractions and the culture of the modern world that we live in, rather than truly pressing on in genuine faith. We must strive to live by faith every day. Though we are saved from sin when we repent and believe in Christ, there is still more to do. We are given the task of going on and growing in our faith. We must press on and work continually at strengthening our relationship with Christ in the way we work at strengthening our earthly relationships. We don't marry our spouse and then just give it minimal effort. So why would we neglect our relationship with our wonderful, faithful, patient God? Although, if you're anything like me, I'm sure you can admit to times when you do let things slip. I certainly can. Maturing in our faith takes time and maximum effort. It's a journey that we must face with perseverance. Daily commitment and service produce maturity. When we are mature in our faith, we won't be swayed or shaken by the temptations of worldly concepts. If we truly trust in Jesus, if we have faith in him, he will transform us completely. A life of obedience and complete trust is pleasing to God. Faith makes us turn around and do what is right, regardless of our past or the disapproval of others. The Old Testament records the lives of various people who experienced great victories through faith, some of whom were mentioned in our reading from Hebrews. And we too can experience victory through our faith in Christ. Our victories may be like those of the Old Testament, but more likely ours will be directly related to the role God wants us to play. Our verses summarise the lives of these men and women of faith. Some experienced outstanding victory, even over the threat of death, but others were severely mistreated, tortured, or even killed for their faith. Having steadfast faith in God doesn't guarantee a happy, carefree life. On the contrary, our faith almost always guarantees some form of abuse from the world, particularly in the most challenging of circumstances. Some facing persecution, war, famine, poverty, and the most devastating effects of climate change. I was really emotional earlier on in the week, following an unexpected visit from a Ukrainian couple who popped into the outreach centre that I work in. The lady spoke very little English and the man spoke none. They managed to communicate that they were living in New Mills with a host. And they had been passing the centre, saw the cross sign on the door, understood the words welcome and loved on our sign, and they came in. In her very limited English, she was able to communicate that she needed help to find church. She needed her Jesus, who had been with her for 30 years. With a real language barrier and a mutual love for and faith in Jesus, we were able to communicate and hopefully help her with their need. But this was the bit that got me. Before she left, she gave me a cuddle and asked if she could pray for me. What did she pray for? That God would protect me. And you can see why that really got me. It's that overwhelming faith that spans nations regardless of our circumstance. I was overwhelmed with emotion when they left. We've often spoken in our house group about this truth, that often Christians who face the toughest challenges have the strongest faith. It often makes me feel shameful about my times of minimal effort, and I can only assume that we in the Western world have too much stuff, too much that distracts us, and that's why that strong faith can put us to shame sometimes. Some of you will have heard me say before about our visit from the Abana Children's Choir from Uganda. They came to our centre to have a big sleepover whilst they were performing in local churches. Some of these children were as young as 6, up to the eldest, who was, I think, 14. They had never been away from home before, and none of their parents were with them. Each night after dinner, they would have some free time. You would hear them play and laugh and run around, excited, loud, noisy, great fun. The moment that the leader announced it was devotion time, these children would climb up as close as they possibly could to him, because they couldn't get enough of the Bible stories that he was going to tell. Young children, they were hungry for more, and nothing would distract them from it. It really challenged me to think about my often distracted times with God. Our faith and the values of this world are on a collision course. The reality is we live in a world full of evil and suffering. Christians are not exempt from the suffering. But the good news is that God is still in control. Jesus endured the greatest suffering imaginable. He understands our fears, our weaknesses, and our disappointments. He promises never to leave us and intercedes on our behalf. In times of trial and pain, we should go in faith, trusting confidently in Christ. Faith enables Christians to face trials with perseverance and endurance. As Christians, we can face trials differently to those with no faith. Genuine faith includes the commitment to stay true to God, even when we are under fire. Often, though, we come through hard times and we look back and we can see how much our faith has grown and strengthened through those times. When we face trials in life, we should stay true to Christ and pray for that endurance that can only come from him. Faith is confident trust in God's promises. I love this image, and I do hope it's helpful for you too. After one has accepted Christ, there are several levels of Christian living. Some live in the basement of Christian experience, inside the building where it's dark, dismal and gloomy. Remembering this is after you have accepted Christ. This is for Christians. Others live on the ground floor, moved beyond the foundation. Some sunlight has entered their lives, but their outlook is limited to the circumstances that surround them. They still live very close to the world. Others live higher still. They're on the upper level. Sunlight and warmth fill the rooms. Noise and distraction of the worldly street doesn't disturb them. Air is pure and outlook is towards the blue, blue sky. These Christians live almost above the world, hidden with Christ and God. God wishes us all to live continuously on this higher floor. Hebrews gives us the names of men and women of faith who lived on the upper floor. But most of us can identify folks known to us who live on that upper floor, folks who just shine. As I read that, people come into my mind. Their faith is tangible and infectious. We learn from them as they take us by the hand, encourage us, and invite us up to that upper level too. Christian folk who truly inspire us. Well, the good news is that the upper floor of faith has enough room. It's big enough for every one of us. These men and women in Hebrews, these men and women of faith in Hebrews all had different stories, but what unites them is their faith. But more than that, a total reliance on their faithful God. The secret to running this race of Christian living is simply allowing Christ to meet all our needs and trust him with everything. It's a marathon, it's not a sprint. A marathon is a strenuous test of fitness and endurance. The race before us requires faith, stamina, commitment, and discipline in order to live faithfully. The race is set before us. We didn't select the course, God did. This race we run for Christ, he chose it. We stay the course in spite of the many trials. As we run, we fix our eyes firmly on Jesus. He is the focus of our lives. We can, in our time, live in this hall of faith, but we must first do two things. We must throw off all that hinders us, strip off all that threatens our relationship with God, and as we run, we must fix our eyes firmly on Jesus. He is the focus of our lives. And secondly, we must truly believe that Jesus is trustworthy. God never intended that we run this race alone. He gives us brothers and sisters, companions for the road. We can achieve so much more together. We complement one another. We attended on Thursday evening the military tattoo at Edinburgh Castle. And I don't know if you've ever been. If you haven't, I highly recommend it. It was my first time. But one of the things for me that was just spine-tingling was the precision and the reliance on each other. And without everybody doing that and doing it for each other, that would all have fallen apart. And it made me think about Christians. It was mesmerising, the precision, the way they all totally relied on each other. And it gave me this image. I thought, see if we all lived our Christian lives like that, with that precision and attention, not only would it be really attractive to everybody else, but the world would be a really wonderful place. There really isn't anything mysterious about faith. It's the simple act of trusting God. Faith makes people strong. That's a fact. So think back to that image that we were talking about, these floors. Where is your faith right now? You don't need to tell me. You can think about that yourself. I know for me, I would love to say I was up in that upper floor, but I'm not. And I think I run up and down the stairs all day, every day. So, yeah, I'm thankful that we have that opportunity. I'm also thankful that we have a faithful, patient God in whom we can trust. He's patient with us. So if you are thinking about where you are on that level, let's all strive to be brave enough to keep climbing to the next floor. Amen. And now we're going to continue our worship with our closing praise, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Thank you.
Just before we close, I just want to say thank you to everybody that helps, because as you all know, it's not just me standing up here, and I couldn't do this if they weren't all doing that. So thank you to everybody that helps. As we go, may the strength of God sustain us. May the power of God preserve us. May the hands of God protect us. May the way of God direct us. And may the love of God go with us this day and forever. Amen. If you'd like to have a seat, we're going to close with a blessing. May the God of peace go with us. And let's sing it to each other. Thank you.